Without them, we could not have worked out such. It was essential for these people to cleanse for us these three chakras, part of the one chakra of Christ. All this they have worked out. And that's why today's Sahaja Yoga is so beautifully created, so beautifully spreading, is working out. We have to thank them very much. Of course, all other incarnations also have helped. You can see Vishuddhi, then also heart and all these, just right heart, left heart, all these angels, as they are called in the Bible, have helped us to cross over. All these incarnations are responsible in our evolutionary process to create these ladders for us to move. So ultimately you reach the state of tapa on the sixth center, and then in the state of truth, satya. Then the truth comes to you through Sahaja Yoga in the brain, in the limbic area, when the kundalini enters. She puts light there, she creates enlightened personalities. And then she joins this all-pervading power of divine love. And with this divine love, you are completely changed and transformed. So their contribution to the ascent of human beings has been great, and that of Christ has been the greatest. And when we say we have to follow Christ, we should try to see how much detachment we have. They say his brothers and sisters or somebody came to see him. They say he had brothers. So he said, "Who are my brothers? These are my brothers. These are my relations." Ganeshwara said the same thing, that they will become your relations. Soyarika. Te chi soyarika. They will be your relations. They will be your brothers and sisters. And not those who are not enlightened. They are not your relations because they don't understand you. They don't have entry into the kingdom of God. So they are not your relations. In his lifetime, he led a life of a person who was very simple, didn't bother about clothes or anything. All the conditioning of the worldly things were not him. But he was not shameless type of a person who would accept any kind of a nudity and this and that. Even about Mahavira, there's a big misconcept. He was once praying in a garden where there were lots of bushes, we call them kunjas. And in the bush his cloth, which was only one cloth he was putting on, was caught up, so he cut half of it and was covering himself. Shri Krishna went to test him and he said, that I have nothing, I'm just nude. So why don't you give me your cloth, because after all, you are a king. So he took out his cloth and gave it to Shri Krishna and got some leaves to cover himself, and he was in his own garden and went into his own palace. Now if you see the Jains, they make everything so horrible and insult him all the time. Most of the people who follow all these great incarnations really all the time insult them. They don't follow, they insult. And by their behavior, you see, we form such a bad opinion of all these people. I met one gentleman in Chicago, it was very cold. He was the head of the Hare Rama, Hare Krishna. He was wearing a dhoti which was so thin and he was shaking before me. I said, "What's the matter?" He said, "I'm feeling very cold." I said, "Why are you wearing this dhoti?" He said, "My guru has told me if you wear a dhoti, you will go to heaven." I said, "Really? In India, 80% people wear nothing but dhotis. Are they all going to go to heaven? And many must have gone already. So where will you be?" Didn't like it. Then I said, "Why you shaved your hair and put this, we call it shendi or in Hindi bodhi, I don't know what you call, pigstail here, pigstail." So he says, "It is because my guru told me that I must shave my head and have this kind of a thing, so I think perhaps maybe he will be tied to some rope and pulled in the heaven or something." I said, Kabira has said, Kabira was one of them who has tried to slash out all your conditioning. He said, by shaving your head, if you are going to go to heaven. So, what about the lamb which is shaved twice a year? He'll be there earlier than you. It's a fact, it's so such stupid things. And there are Jain sadhus who will remain absolutely nude and will pull their hair. Now by law they are allowed to go nude on the street, you know, insulting everyone. All such stupid things are happening in the name of religion, that too of Buddha, Mahavira and Christ. They are the ones who are trying to pull us away from rationality. Because you have to cross this. All your limitations are because of this thinking, conditioning. We have to go beyond, because by thinking, what do? We move in a linear way and then there is no truth in it, so the whole thing comes back, boomerangs, and you are finished. We have to go beyond this mind, must understand this point is. Christ has done this so that we can go beyond our mind. If you don't know how to go beyond mind, better sit down for your meditation. Work it out. With this mind, all kinds of things will come. Temper will come. Intrigue will come. Jealousies will come. All the six enemies that we have will come to us through this mind. Means thinking, rationality. Everything can be rationalized. Why did you murder your wife? Because I hated her. She was this, she was that, she was that. But you cannot murder her. Why did you murder your husband? Because of this, because of that. Because of this mind, we start doing things which are absolutely wrong, which are sinful, and then we try to rationalize it. Go against agya. Go against reality and then use your conditioning, use your, we can call the ego to explain it, why you did it. All the time when we are doing like that, we can never go beyond mind. We are so self-satisfied about ourselves. We think no end of ourselves. Now, how are we to get out of it? Introspection. But it's very difficult because people are afraid of themselves. They don't want to introspect. Because once they start introspecting, they will know how sinful they have been, how wrong things they have been doing. And then they'll hate themselves. So they don't want to introspect. But it's very important that we should introspect. That introspection is very helpful for you to overcome these two hurdles of your Ajna Chakra. I have told you many times, don't argue with anybody. Because the other fellow who is asking for argument is the one who has lots of ego. And that ego is acting on you. So action-reaction starts. And we develop a habit of reacting to everything. Especially in the West I have seen they react to everything. Everything. For example, now this thing is spread out here. Now they have nothing to do. But they could have had better. Why is it so thin? Oh, you pay for it now, you do it. They are walking across, they meet someone, see this man, what sort of a person he is. If there's a beggar, then they'll start criticizing. They'll criticize the government, they'll criticize everyone. What about yourself? Instead of that, why don't you start doing something about it? If you can't help it, if you are not going to do anything about it, why react? And this is the worst habit we have developed, is to react. And we think we have every right to react. You have. But this right is self-destructive. To react on everything is not proper. You have no authority to react. It is to that extent. You have to just witness. Witness the whole thing. Once you start witnessing, you'll be amazed that you will start seeing the play. Play of the Maya, as they call it, and you will see where you stand with it. Witnessing should be developed all the time. Witness. Am I witnessing? Many people say that I have very good memory. Because I'm all the time witnessing. Everything is recorded within me like a picture. And then when I have to say something, I have to correct something, all that I have witnessed comes to help me. First of all, we should not react. React to anything. Some people are attached, say, to money. They react, they'll not give any money, they'll keep all the money with themselves. In sadhguru also it happens. I've seen people who are very, very miserly about money. Another ones are who try to please others. Then they'll waste their money on lavish things for nothing at all. There's no need to waste. Reaction can come through anything. Seeing something, you can react. And you become so engrossed with it that you don't realize that you are wasting all your brain energy on nonsensical things. This reaction comes when you have lost complete sense of judgment. You don't know what you are losing, what you are gaining by this kind of reaction. And this reaction is going to destroy your inner being completely. Because all the time you are here and you are there and you are there and you are there, you are nowhere here. If you are a very criticizing type of a person, try to stop it completely. Criticize yourself. Direct that energy towards yourself. Who am I to criticize others? Who am I to react to anything? Put a challenge to yourself and you will see that your ego will subside. One day somebody came and told me, that, Mother, I feel so angry, I feel like beating everyone. I said, all right, do one thing, take a chappal and hit on your head, finished. That's the only way you can get rid of this habit, that you want to beat others. didn't like it much, but I think by that he is improved. Now conditioning also should be seen. Am I a conditioned person? If my conditioning is there, then is it a good conditioning or a bad condition? At least you should have good conditioning. But even that, to an extreme if you go, you can create a problem for yourself and for others. Most of these rituals and things started as a good conditioning. Then it became like a trap, and they could not get out of it. It's a part and parcel of it, one has to accept. Then what should we do? We should not react. Just see the drama. And you'll be surprised. Without paying anything, without going to any theatre, every moment you can see the drama going on before you, which is so enjoyable. Whether it is absurd, whether it is ridiculous, whether it is a sort of a, as you see in the films, you see beating somebody and all that, you just see it and you do not react. Anything that you think is very perverse, ugly, immoral, don't see, finished, gone. So don't tax your mind, because in the mind that we call it, so-called mind, is actually the Agya Chakra in the center of your optic chiasma. Just imagine what a central place it has. And any disturbance to your Agya, what it can do to your brain, which is nothing but a lump of fat. So how this Agya can affect you and how it works and creates perverted images, that is to be really seen. Conditionings also you have seen, people are mentally so upset and so degenerated. But the pure nature of Christ is innocence, you know that. He is Sri Ganesha. Sri Ganesha is an eternal child. Christ is also complete innocence because he doesn't react. Because he is not conditioned. Children are not conditioned so much as we are. If you talk to children, if you speak to them, you will be amazed how innocent they are and how innocently they talk. Once my granddaughter asked me, "What do you think of the poor children of the tiger?" I said, "Why? You know, their father tells them that you eat human beings. And what can they do? They have to eat human beings after all." So innocent. So I told her that they are under a complete control of God. Whatever they are doing, they are not going to be held responsible for. It's only for human beings. That God has given this freedom. It's only human beings who can react in this manner. So, for animal cities, they are in, pashus means they are completely under the control of the God Almighty. So they are swabhavas, everything. A serpent will be a serpent and a tiger will be a tiger and they will say a lion will be a lion. But human being can be a serpent at the same time, could be a scorpion, could be a lion, could be anything, you know. Suddenly you find a small little bug-like man coming up like a lion roaring at you. And you say, from where does this come, this cannon? It is so. You don't know which way they will come and which way the camel will sit, you can't say. So this reaction of human beings comes because he is not in connection with the Divine. When he is in the connection with the Divine, he sees the drama and he leaves everything to Divine. He can solve all his problem by just one bandhan. Aye, Pani, tum basa. He can solve all the problems just by a bandhan. But he should be in full connection with the Divine. It works. It works. It does work. This is not the time when Christ came on this earth. This is the time when this Parama Chaitanya has gone into action, activated, is working out everything. Now they asked me about the Sri Ganesha, whether Sri Ganesha drank milk or not. I said, anything possible. These days this Parama Chaitanya is doing such things, unbelievable things which we cannot understand. Everything is a chamatkar. So, it's possible. Ganeshas, I have never heard of Ganesha liking milk so much, but maybe for the little rat he might be drinking. You can't say. But why did Shiva drink? I said, let it be. Let Shiva wants to drink, let him have milk. Actually, we have too much milk production, so they must be wanting to consume some. But it's just a way at looking at things that, you see, when everything is done by this Param Chaitanya, they are doing such wonderful things. I mean, I never asked them to do anything. But now, for example, in Brisbane when I was there, I was sleeping in the ashram and a rainbow appeared. Of course, I like paintings very much of Raphael, especially because he has drawn the mother's face and the child's face so exactly, expressing the feeling of mother and the child. And imagine that picture appears in the sky. And I didn't tell them to show that Raphael. When I was sleeping, I was not even going to look at it. But at this time, the hollow that was on the back side of Mary comes up on the head. Means Raphael himself did it, or I don't know. How can I explain this? Param Chaitanya is doing all kinds of things, and it does all this just to convince you about Sahaja. Because even now there are many who are supposed to be very rational, intelligent, educated, who don't want to accept. After all, if there is a divine power, if there is something like that and is active, how can you challenge it? How can you say no to it? Because the powers are unlimited. It has gone into every atom and every molecule. It doesn't do tricks like moving this from there to there. But what it does is to do something which is absolutely impossible. It is doing. So for us to believe in this activated Param Chaitanya is the only solution, so you leave it in the ocean of this and let this great power handle all the situations. Don't react yourself, which is so efficient, so quick, so fast, moves all over, understands everything, and it loves you and respects you because you are Sahaja Yogis. This is what it is today. We should know at the time when we are celebrating Christmas, that what we are celebrating is really our own ascent, our own achievements, our own lofty heights which we have achieved and which we have to achieve. We should have only aspirations as far as our spiritual side is concerned. All aspirations should be left to this Param Chaitanya, you look after that. And the more you become, the more you develop this non-reacting attitude through your proper agya. Not anger, not silence, but a very pleasant temperament. That means people think that I've told you not to speak. No, you must speak. You must talk to people, you must laugh, you must enjoy. But all this should be full of joyous feelings. That's what they say, that Christmas is for a very joyous atmosphere. So they can't do that way, so they drink. After all, you must give them benefit of doubt also, that why do they drink? They think by drinking they will become joyous. Now, our understanding about ourselves has to be very clear. Especially people don't meditate. They just don't meditate. They don't want to grow. They are sahayogis, but they don't meditate. It's very surprising. I can make out who meditates, who does not. Because there is no depth. They want to have this, they want to have that, is all right. But what about meditation? If you don't meditate, your agya will be completely covered with thoughts and you will be lost. So you have to meditate. If you don't meditate, I also suffer. If you have no aspirations in Sahayoga, it's better to leave. Because you are like seeds which are sprouted and which will be wasted. Some people are here because they want some sort of a platform, some publicity. Some are here who want money, to make money out of Sahayoga. There are some who want to have a kind of a communication to go around the whole world without paying a single path. All such people are of no use to themselves. Now here you have the complete wealth. All that celestial wealth is before you, and you are not going to accept it. You are not going to drown into it. What should we say? This is not very sensible to do. As I said, you don't have to crucify yourself, you don't have to give up anything, you don't have to live like Christ had to live or be born in the manger. All that's done for you already. Now, come along. But if you are coming in the darbar of the Divine, then be worth it. You should be worth it. And you will be surprised, all your problems will be solved. Your self-respect will be maintained. So many things have happened like that. But if you have no self-respect, you don't respect your realization, you are not deeply involved as to your own ascent and the help to others, it will not work out. I am here to tell you all these things which Christ could not tell. I had to fulfill what He wanted to say. All those things I am saying to you, it has already worked, you have all got realization. But develop respect for yourself as sahayogis. Don't have funny ideas about yourself. Just know you are a sahayogi and a sahayogi. That's what is needed for a person if he is today celebrating the birth of Christ. He came on this earth who was actually Christ, full of innocence, who was the one who came as the embodiment of Sri Ganesha. I have given the proof of it to you, how the carbon atom looks like, and by which I have proved that Christ is the Alpha and Omega, while He is made out of Omkara and Swastika. All this we have experimented, we have found it, it's there. With all this, what is the greatest achievement is to respect your innocence. Respect your innocence. This is what is to be asked for today. Be innocent, and God looks after all the innocent people. Don't worry, don't have to worry. I have seen children falling for 7 stories, nothing happens to them. They are perfectly all right. How? Who looks after? Angels. You have seen photographs of angels around you. So try to be simple, innocent, not reactive, and keep quiet and peaceful. Because here we are talking about the global transformation where people will find their peace in their heart and will establish a new world of peace, joy, and spirituality. May God bless you all.